Okay. So continuing the endocrine system. So I told some endocrine disorders in the last class. Even I covered the parathyroid and also the adrenal gland. So and also the pineal gland, pineoblastoma I also told. And some pituitary tumors I told you. Pituitary conditions, the hyper and hypofunctioning and also the neoplastic tumors. Next, continuing, this is neuroblastoma. Neuroblastoma. So as the name indicates, any blastoma means it's a primitive tumor. Arising a neoplastic condition arising from the primitive germ cells or blast cells. So we have retinoblastoma, nephroblastoma, neuroblastoma, pancreatoblastoma. So many blastomas are there, which all indicate the tumors arising from the primitive blast-like primitive cells. So these are the primitive neural cells, so neuroblasts, and the proliferation is called as neuroblastoma. It is a rare and highly malignant tumor found in infants and children. Generally all these blastomas we find in children only. Less than 5, 6 years or 10 years we find in mostly infants and children we find. They are derived from the sympathetic cells. They are sympathetic cells and they secrete catecholamines. Because you know the sympathetic cells, they secrete the sympathomimetic substances called catecholamines or the adrenergic substances. So you find the raised blood or urinary catecholamines. They're important diagnostic features. And they spread to the liver, skin and bones, and occasionally mature to a ganglion neuroma, which is a benign tumor. So some of these primitive cells in the course of the tumor, they may mature into ganglion neuroma, the cells which are more differentiated. And the prognosis depends on age of the patient, the stage. The stage means your the stage of the tumor. Means to how much the tumor has extended or metastasis has spread. It also depends on the stage. Also depends on the histology. Histology means the microscopic picture or the microscopic features or findings. So which tells about how much aggressive the cells are. Whether the degree of differentiation, the aggressiveness. So all those things are estimated in the histological findings. And the ploidy. Ploidy means the amount these neoplastic cells have, how much of this chromosome, whether it is a diploid or triploid, or how much more additional chromosomal content is there in the neoplastic cells. They are, is it aneuploidy or diploidy like that? Okay. And also the amplification of the NMIG gene. The NMIG gene amplification also is important, which determines the prognosis of neuroblastoma. These NMIG, they are all the different oncogenes. So these oncogenes also will, the conversion of proto-oncogenes to oncogenes also will determine the extent of the neoplastic condition. And the expression of some proteins like TRK, these are called some molecules of proteins, and these molecules when they are expressed, there will be more proliferation of the tumor there. So they will tell about the degree of proliferation or the proliferation markers. They are called the cell nuclear cell proliferation markers. So these expression also will determine the prognosis. And the response of the tumor cells to the treatment, all these things are estimated or determined by all these factors, prognostic factors. So, this histologically or microscopically, you find this this type of appearance. You find these small cells. They're called the small round cells or small round blue cells. So these small round blue cells, you know, they're closely packed. You can see in the form of shades. They're all the neuroblast cells, the primitive neural cells. The neuroblastic cells. So these are primitive round blue cells. This is small round blue cells, and it comes under the category of small round cell tumors. There's a category of round cell tumors having this primitive small round blue cells, and it has a long list of tumors. And that in that category, this neuroblastoma comes. They're called round cell tumors. Okay, having small round blue cells in neurofibrillary background. Neurofibrillary means you find the background will be having some degree of neural fibrillary, areas and the neural bundles like that. And sometimes we can find the rosettes, small rosette-like structures. They're called the homerite rosettes. having a blood vessel inside the rosette, or the flower like pattern, the flower petals like pattern of cells, and inside there you find the space having the blood vessel. It's called the homoerotic rosettes. And depending on the differentiation of the tumor, they are called whether they are well or moderately or differentiated. We can find depending on the differentiation, they are called either ganglioneuroblastoma or ganglioneuromas. So depending on differentiation, these tumors are called either ganglioneuroblastoma if they're not well differentiated, if they're well differentiated and having the mature ganglion neurons, they're called as ganglioneuromas. So there are different degrees of differentiation, either the primitive cells or mild differentiation or moderate differentiation or well differentiation. So that is depending on that, you find the different elements of the neural elements, either the blasts or the ganglion and the different the mature neuron cells. So different areas we find in the tumor of these areas. So that's all about the neuroblastoma, which can occur in your adrenal medulla. That's a tumor which occurs in the adrenal medulla, having all these neural elements and neural endings, neuroblast cells, primitive neural cells. Next, coming to MEN. MEN means multiple endocrine neoplasia. So multiple endocrine neoplasia or MEN, it is a group of in these syndromes you find multiple tumors of different systems together, they are present in the same patient. So the multiple tumor, that's why they're called MEN syndromes or multiple endocrine neoplasia syndromes. So group of genetically inherited of multiple endocrine neoplasms, mostly, as I told you, as the name indicates, endocrine tumors, thyroid, parathyroid, adrenal, pituitary, like that, all these endocrine tumors you find. And some distinctive features they have, like they occur more in the younger age, and also they are either synchronous or metachronous. Either they occur simultaneously in two different organs, or one after another. So one tumor occurring in thyroid and the second tumor occurring in parathyroid after some weeks or months, like that. So either simultaneously in different endocrine organs, or one after another in different endocrine organs. So synchronous or metachronous. Okay. So they are multifocal. You find multiple locations you find the tumors, and in multiple areas of the same organ also you can find at a time they appear within same organ, and they are more aggressive, and recurrence is also common. They even when they are treated or surgically removed, again they will recur. So this is more aggressive, and the recurrence is also common in case of these tumors, endocrine neoplasms or multiple endocrine neoplasia. So there are different types. It's called MEN type 1. MEN type 1 is also called Wermer syndrome. It's characterized by three P's. Three P's means there will be parathyroid hyperplasia or adenomas, pancreatic lesions, pituitary adenomas. So you find involvement of parathyroid adjoining the thyroid, or pancreatic lesions also we find. You know, pancreas also has endocrine portion. It has both exocrine and endocrine portion. Endocrine is your insulin, glucagon secreting cells, somatostatin secreting cells. So you have the endocrine component of pancreas, you are well aware of it. And pituitary, you have the hypophysis tumors, adenohypophysis and neurohypophysis. So all the endocrine neoplasms can occur either synchronously or metachronously in different organs. And you find a germline mutation in So you find the germline mutations in MEN1 gene coding. Mutation. So MEN1 gene coding mutation you find where this gene, when it is affected, is present in all these endocrine glands, parathyroid, pancreas, and pituitary, and subsequently that's why they will develop these multiple endocrine tumors because of the common gene in, present in all these endocrine glands. Okay. Next, MEN type 2A. MEN type 2A is called a simple syndrome. It's characterized by medullary carcinoma of thyroid. It's a type of carcinoma of thyroid, malignancy of thyroid, which I'll tell you subsequently in thyroid and neoplastic conditions. We have different types of carcinomas of thyroid. Okay. And it has C-cell hyperplasia. C-cells means the parafollicular cells, which are present in the circumference of the thyroid follicles, and they produce calcitonin, So these are called parafollicular abscessions, and they will undergo hyperplasia. They increase in number, okay, and they produce more calcitonin. And there will be pheochromocytoma, which I told you yesterday. That is the your tumor of the adrenal medulla for the chromaffin cells, okay. There is called pheochromocytoma. The rule of 10 I told you. It has the rule of 10. Follows all the 10% in all the features. Parathyroid hyperplasia also occurs, and the germline mutation in RET protoprogen. Okay, for protoprogen. So this is how we find. This is MEN type 2A. That was type A, and this is type 2A or Sickle syndrome, and that was Vermeer syndrome. And MEN type 2B. This is another type where you find also. It's called mucosal neuroma syndrome. So you find multiple mucosal neuromas in the mucosal areas, as similar to MEN 2A, with additional features also. So mucocutaneous neuromas are ganglion neuromas and marfanoid habitus. So we have mucocutaneous neuromas are there will be different neuromas in the oral cavity and other mucosal area, GI tract, and ganglion neuromas having the ganglion proliferation in the neural bundles, and marfanoid habitus, Marfan syndrome, you must have been told in another chapter. So it's like a marfanoid characteristic features. It's called marfanoid habitus. With a tall face and other things. So the features we have in Marfan syndrome. And a single amino acid change occurs in RET, the red oncogene, which is distinct from the MEN2B. Distinct from MEN2A actually. Okay. So like this is a MEN2B. Okay, that is all about the multiple endocrine neoplasia syndromes and the different types, and how the different multiple endocrine tumors occur in different glands, and neuroblastoma and adrenal medulla, I told you already. Next, coming to the next topic, that is thyroid gland. Thyroid. The next endocrine gland we study is thyroid. So it's all about knowing the different clinical features of hypo and hyperthyroidism. So just like other endocrine glands, here also you find hyperfunctioning and hypofunctioning. And also thyroid tumors. And also we have thyroid inflammatory conditions also here. It's common. So we should also know what is the autoimmune condition. You know, autoimmune diseases also, we have an example of thyroid disease called autoimmune thyroiditis. And also Graves' disease. It's also one of the immune-mediated disease with some different features. It's called Graves' disease. Or also called exophthalmic goiter or exophthalmus. And know the different appearances and clinical course of the major types of thyroid tumors. Different appearances and clinical course of major types of thyroid tumors, how they appear grossly and microscopically, and the clinical course, and with different prognostic factors and different prognosis, prognostic rates. So we will study all these things in thyroid disorders. So this is a normal thyroid gland. You can see two lobes are there, and a median lobe is there. How the gland is appearing, because of colloid, it's looking brownish and reddish brown like appearance. So in normal histology, you find thyroid has got different follicles, different round to oval follicles, almost these varying sizes you find having lined with thyroid follicular cells. And in the center of each follicle, you find this eosinophilic pink colored thing. This is nothing but the colloid. The thyroid gland produces the hormones T3 and T4, and they bind with the thyroglobulin protein. And the thyroglobulin along with the T3, T4 forms the colloid. And this colloid is deposited in the lumen of the thyroid follicles. So in that way, you find it's a unique endocrine gland where the product of the gland is combined with protein, and that protein, that stored thing, is deposited in the lumen of the thyroid follicles, giving rise to this type of appearance. This is how you find the appearance of thyroid follicles. And in between that, you find the blood vessels supplying the follicles, everything, and the small the fibroconnective tissue, the stromal tissue, everything will find. So this is the simple structure of the microscopic features of the normal thyroid gland. Okay, the colloid. Whenever the colloid has to be T3-T4 has to come out, it has to go again. The colloid will again go into the cells, and from the cells, from the other side, it is released into the blood vessels, and then it goes into circulation to act on the different target organs where the T3 and T4 will act. Okay, so the triiodo and tetraiodo thyroid, that is the T3 and T4. But the iodine is required, you know, for the synthesis of the T3 T4. That is important. The source of iodine is important. Okay. So you should also remember the normal histological and the physiological functions of the T3, T4, which you have read in your basic sciences. Is important. So briefly, that is thyroid is controlled by the hypothalamus, which produces the TRH. The TRH means thyroid releasing hormone, the TSH, thyroid stimulating thyroid releasing hormone, or TSH releasing hormone, which will stimulate the pituitary to from the thyrotrope cells to produce the TSH or thyroid stimulating hormone. And TSH will act on the thyroid gland to stimulate the production of T3 and T4, entry of iodine and activation of cells, and then release of production of T3, T4, and then it is stored in the lumen of the thyroid follicles. So like that, you know the normal physiology of thyroid, TRH, TSH and T3, T4. That is how the thyroid physiology, in brief, you should understand. Okay. And as I told you, in the endocrine things, there is a negative feedback mechanism. So the pituitary hormones will act on the TRH when the level will decrease, it stimulates that to produce more. And when T3, T4 is decreased, there is a positive feedback mechanism on the pituitary to release more TSH. And if in the blood levels T3, T4 is less, it will again have a negative positive feedback mechanism to stimulate more T3, T4 like that. You have three different loops or the positive and negative feedback mechanism in regulating the levels. When the level decreases or increases, it will apply send feedback mechanism to the gland, and then ultimately the amount of the regulating or controlling hormones will either decrease or increase. That is how it happens. That is, regulatory hormones are controlled by this positive and negative feedback mechanism. That is all about the normal thyroid physiology. So coming to disorders of thyroid. The different disorders of thyroidism, like other endocrine glands, is only hyperfunctioning, that is hyperthyroidism, hypofunctioning or hypothyroidism, that is production of more T3-T4 and less T3-T4, and thyroiditis. As I told you, there is, it also has some inflammatory conditions because of some infections and by bacteria or virus, and also some autoimmune conditions also, non-infective inflammatory condition, like autoimmune destruction and some other mechanisms. There is a non-infective inflammatory condition also occurs in thyroid, that is called. So there are different types of thyroiditis that I will tell you in subsequently. And also we have one condition called MNGR, goiter, that is deficiency of iodine. Because iodine is so essential for production of the T3-T4. When there is deficiency of iodine, there will be some various physiological changes in the gland because of the feedback mechanism by the T3-T4, decreased levels of T3-T4, stimulating the gland continuously, and then because of stimulation, there is activation of follicles and enlargement of follicles, and these cycles will repeat and leading to ultimately MNG, that is called multinodular goiter, also called as nodular goiter, same thing. MNG or NG are same thing. Simple goiter is there, and this is the repeated cycles of these goiter and the changes in the gland that leads to some changes like fibrosis and other things, leading to a large enlarged some gland areas called MNG or nodular goiter. And also we have neoplasms. The neoplasms or neoplastic conditions we have, that is where you find where some various adenomas and carcinomas we have. That's called neoplastic conditions. We have various benign tumors and malignant conditions like adenomas and some carcinomas we have, that I will tell you in the under the portion of neoplastic conditions of thyroid. So hyperthyroidism, hypothyroidism, thyroiditis, multinodular goiter and neoplasms are the various classification of different categories of diseases of thyroid gland. And also we have some congenital conditions called thyroglossal cysts. So the thyroglossal cysts also can occur in the due to some congenital anomalies, where you find some cystic spaces developing in the thyroid gland, they're called thyroglossal cysts. Okay. So the causes of hyperthyroidism. Okay. So hyperfunctioning. So what are the conditions where you find hyperfunctioning of thyroid are called hyperthyroidism? That is, one is called as diffuse hyperplasia, where you find the Graves disease also has autoimmune mechanism, where you find the entire gland is completely hyperplastic and produces more amount of T3-T4, called as diffuse hyperplasia of the gland, and the entire gland is diffusely enlarged, called Graves disease. Next is hyperfunctioning adenoma, where you find neoplastic proliferation of some cells of thyroid follicles, and that is called hyperfunctioning adenoma, also called as Plummer syndrome. And next is the TSH producing pituitary. The TSH producing pituitary or neuroendocrine tumor. That is, as I told you, in pituitary you have the thyrotropic cells, adenoma also, where they produce more thyroid stimulating hormone, TSH. that is called TSH producing pituitary or thyrotrophoma in pituitary gland or hypophysis, or any other neuroendocrine tumor occurring in the pituitary, which will cause general enlargement of all the cells of pituitary, and also the produces more TSH, and this more TSH will act on the thyroid gland to stimulate it to produce more T3T4, leading to hyperthyroidism or hyperfunctioning of thyroid gland. So there are so many mechanisms, because there are so many different levels of control, the different mechanisms how the T3T4 can be increased or the hyperfunctioning. And iatrogenic means they are due to some due to some treatment, over treatment of hypothyroidism. So in some patients, due to some wrong calculation of doses, when they are given more T3T4 than what is required as with the levels of T3T4 TSH in their body, and if it is wrongly calculated or some wrong treatment is given, then there is over treatment of hypothyroidism leading to again hyperthyroidism. That is called iatrogenic, or it is because of treatment effects due to some erroneous treatment. So there are different symptoms of hyperthyroidism. When the person has more T3T4, you know, his metabolic rate will increase more, because thyroid hormones will stimulate the metabolism in the body. They will stimulate everything. Okay, your heart rate, your respiratory rate, all these things, your other body, your neural functions, everything, they will stimulate and they will activate more. So there will be more hair loss, more lid retraction, lid contraction of muscles, goiter. Goiter is also more because of creating a deficiency of iodine-like state, because of more requirement of iodine. And palpitations because of more heart rate, tachycardia, increased heart rate, atrial fibrillation because of some atria and disc, it will contract more. Okay, fibrillation, a more intestinal motility called causing diarrhea, and also because of more vasodilation and more blood supply, the warm and moist palms, the tremors also will occur because of more neurogenic stimulation, and destruction of nails or onycholysis, and acrobachy, some disease of your fingers, and pre-tibial. Myxedema because of deposition of some collagenous and material substance in your shin of the tibia called pre-tibial myxedema, and angiotensin exophthalmos because of the protrusion of eyeball and deposition of some myxoid material behind the eye. It pushes the eye forwards. Okay, and weight loss because of more rapid metabolism of the body, of the food we take, there is weight loss. Menorrhagia because of the more endometrial secretion. There's activation of the cycles, menstrual cycles in females. Osteoporosis because of more bone resorption, and also proximal myopathy because of muscle wasting. Okay, more muscle wasting occurs also. So all these things are because of the hyperthyroidism. You should remember some of these. Some of these will be there in different patients of different hyperfunctioning thyroid or thyroid hyperthyroidism. Causes of hypothyroidism. So hypothyroidism means the opposite of hyperthyroidism, where you find the less secretion of T3T4 and there will be decreased function of the thyroid, and you find lesser secretion of T3T4 leading to hypothyroidism. Okay. So these causes of hypothyroidism are congenital metabolic defects called cretinism. Metabolic defects. Iodine deficient diet. It will definitely cause decreased T3T4 production and hypothyroidism. Autoimmune thyroiditis causing destruction of thyroid follicles and glands, leading to less production of T3T4. Post-thyroidectomy, when more of thyroid gland is removed during surgeries in case of tumors and other conditions, where the normal thyroid will be very less than decreased production of T3T4. Pituitary insufficiency will be there, where you'll find the decreased functioning of the thyrotrope cells in the pituitary, causing less production of TSH, production of thyroid stimulating hormones, and thereby less activation of thyroid gland and less T3T4. And some idiopathic causes are also there, unknown. So there are different conditions or causes of hypothyroidism in contrast to the hyperthyroidism. So there are various features of hypothyroidism. They are almost opposite to the earlier ones. Slow cerebration, dry hair. Okay, cerebration will be slow. The brain development is slow. The dry hair, there you find more hair loss, there is dry hair. A face will also be look very much a myxedemic face or more swelling, and voice also will be very rough. Ischemic heart disease occurs, ECG changes will be there, bradycardia is there. There you find tachycardia, here you find bradycardia and the corresponding ECG changes. There you find diarrhea, here you find constipation, and some deposition of the myxoid material causing carpal tunnel syndrome, compression of your some nerves in the hands. Dry cold skin, there you find wet skin and warm skin, and the hypothermia. And here is the psychosis, loss of outer third of eyebrows, deafness and goiter will be there here also. Okay, diminished sweating occurs. There more sweating, slow activity here. Weight gain occurs. There you find weight loss. Here there will be slow metabolism for weight gain, and menstrual irregularities also occurs here, and muscle weakness also occurs. These are the different all features of the hypothyroidism. Coming to thyroid goiter. Goiter means any swelling actually, swelling in the neck. Okay, mostly it's due to deficiency of iodine. Any enlargement of the thyroid getting a neck mass. It can be due to cysts or hyperplasia or benign adenoma or carcinoma. Any swelling. Okay, so goiter. That generally you've said this swelling in the neck. Diffuse MNG or multinodular goiter, as I told you, or nodular goiter. There are two types. Endemic type and sporadic. Endemic means occurring where at the same time large number of people are affected when the iodine deficiency is there, right? Sporadic type means sometimes in some occasional some people occurs, and some cassava beans it produces thiocyanate and iodine transport is affected. So in that we're taking those cassava beans also affects the iodine intake and the goiter. Sporadic there will be rare and females and young people are affected, and there are two stages: hyperplastic stage and colloid stage. And the repeated attacks will lead to multinodular goiter. The repeated attacks of these goiter iron deficiency in different episodes will lead to MNG, multinodular goiter, because there will be hyperplasia of the follicles, fibrosis of these intervening areas, cystic change, and necrosis. All these things will cause diffuse multinodular goiter. And mass effect is there because of this goiter large swelling. Mass effect in the surrounding structures, you know, surrounding structures like your trachea also can be affected. The swelling is very large. It affects on the esophagus and trachea and other larynx also. So producing voice changes and also the difficulty in breathing, all those things can occur sometimes. The swelling is very large. And that case, surgical intervention will be required to remove the excess swelling. Okay. Mass effect, dysphagia, airway obstruction. And rarely it will lead to toxic features like hyperthyroidism. Suddenly a large amount of P3-D4 which is already produced, which goes into circulation, it produces sudden hyperthyroidism, producing toxic features, or is Plummer syndrome. That also is possible. You can see an MNG. On different nodules, you can find your nodular goiter. Gross specimen, you can find the different nodules where the entire gland is removed. You find the different, that's why it's called nodular and multinodular goiter. And the intervening areas, you find all fibrosis and cystic change. You can find all those things. Coming to Graves' disease. So it is also a type of autoimmune-mediated disease with some other features are also there. Occurs more in females and occurs in 20 to 40 years, and there's a triad of clinical features, three features. Mostly there's a hyperthyroidism. Exophthalmos means the protrusion of eyeball. Eyeball comes out because of deposition of something, some myxoid material behind the eye. You find exophthalmos. And critical myxedema. Again, the myxomatous material depositing in the your lower leg in front of tibia. That's called critical myxedema. It's very non-pitting type of edema. If the edema is watery, pitting type, here it is only myxoid material, myxomatous material. When you press it, you find it's non-pitting. You find the pit will remain like that, non-pitting edema. So these three features are the classical features of Graves' disease, having hyperthyroidism, exophthalmos, and pre-tibial mixed edema. And autoimmune condition. It has some autoimmune basis also, where you find the antibodies destroying the thyroid follicles. It's called autoimmune basis. And the antibody to TSH receptors. There will be antibody to TSH receptors. It's called LATS. LAT means long-acting thyroid stimulating antibodies. So these antibodies actually stimulate the thyroid follicles to produce more thyroid hormones. They're called as long-acting thyroid stimulating antibodies. Okay, they're antibody to the TSH receptors, and they will stimulate. They are, instead of suppressing, they will stimulate. They're stimulatory antibodies. When they combine with the receptors, they will produce more TSH, more thyroid stimulating hormone, leading to more TSH and more T and P3-D4. Like that. So you find this exophthalmos, how the eyes are coming out, protruded. So that's why it's called exophthalmic, and this is a goiter, you can see. So these two conditions together, it's called exophthalmic goiter. Diffuse hyperplasia, leading to where you find the tall columnar cells and papillary folds. Okay, because of hyperplasia, you find these tall columnar cells and these papillary folds, you can find the finger-like structures, folds you can find. And scallops. Scallops means you find here the empty space, you see, in the adjoining that, because of the more colloid absorption, because the colloid is more released into blood, or the T3-T4. So there is a scalloping, or the empty spaces you can see in the border of the colloid. scallop pale and scanty color you can find, because it means more T3T4 is coming out of the lumen and going to bread. So this is all the scalloping, you can see pale and scanty color, and it is you can see this scalloping. That is all about briefly about Graves' disease. Next, coming to the different types of thyroiditis. The thyroiditis. So as I told you, there are different condition. One is called because due to bacteria, it's called bacterial thyroiditis. When you find suppurative pharyngitis, any inflammation, pus causing inflammation of pharynx, it can extend into the thyroid because of the extension of severe infection, and there will be bacterial thyroiditis. And autoimmune thyroiditis is Hashimoto's thyroiditis, where you find the antibodies are formed against the thyroid gland and they destroy the follicles and leading to some inflammatory reaction. It's called Hashimoto's thyroiditis. And you have granulomatous thyroiditis. Granulomatous thyroiditis. We have viral thyroiditis. It's also called viral thyroiditis because of some viral infection. There will be thyroiditis where you find some granulomas will occur in the thyroid gland. Some collections of giant cells and some other thyroid follicle cells you find. And reduced thyroiditis. Reduced means you find severe fibrosis in the neck, and that fibrosis extending into the neck, into the thyroid, leading to involvement of thyroid and for and the inflammatory change in the thyroid. That is called reduced thyroiditis. There's an extension of fibrosis from the neck into the thyroid gland in some various conditions. And palpation thyroiditis, when we palpate the thyroid gland unnecessarily for more time. So this mechanical palpation or the pressure due to palpation can lead to this focal chronic non-specific inflammation. Usually when many people palpate, like you know, bedside examination, you know, all the medical students palpate thyroid gland of the same patient continuously, that palpation also will disturb the thyroid and there will be inflammatory reaction. That's called chronic non-specific inflammation. The repeated palpation leads to this kind. That's called palpation thyroiditis. So bacterial thyroiditis, autoimmune thyroiditis, granulomatous thyroiditis, reduced thyroiditis, and palpation thyroiditis. All these are different types of thyroiditis and inflammatory conditions of the thyroid. Some are infectious, some are to be infective cause, some are non-infective also. So coming to Hashimoto's thyroiditis. So Hashimoto's thyroiditis. So it's a common non-endemic goiter. Non-endemic goiter. Sporadic. Okay, non-endemic means sporadic, means occurring occasionally. Occurring in women in 3 to 5 decades of life. And it's an autoimmune basis that is linked to HLA DR5 and DR3. So leading to which the self, the antibodies produced in the body are acting on the self antigens. So it's an autoimmune type of thyroiditis, self antibodies. And pathogenesis is due to the three autoantibodies. Autoantibodies means, I think you know, those antibodies which act on our own body cells because of some non-recognition or misrecognition. Okay, they wrongly think that they are foreign cells and they will act on the body's own antigens, antigenic cells, components. So three autoantibodies like anti-TSH, there is the antibody to TSH, a thyroid-stimulating hormone, anti-microsomal. They will act against the microsomal component. Microsomes are present in the one type of cell organelle present in the cell, the thyroid follicular cells, and anti-thyroglobulin antibodies. They will act on the thyroglobulin antibodies. Okay, that is the thyroglobulin present in the colloid. The antibodies will act on that and will destroy the colloid this protein. So the three types of antibodies are recommended: anti-TSH, anti-microsomal, and anti-thyroglobulin. And there will be cytotoxic T cell damage. T cell means T lymphocytes can also can damage by means of cytotoxic methods and directly damage the your follicular cells by some antigen recognition and this T cell mediated damage to the follicular cells. So this, in this way, we can find damage to the follicular cells in this phase, in these ways, and by antibodies and also by the T cells. So because of that, you can find a form diffuse goiter. You can see the diffuse goiter, and the lymph node is looking like a lymph node. So lymph node like appearance. Okay. So you can find the various atrophic. They are all the atrophic follicles. Very small, rudimentary like follicles having no colloid because of destruction by all these antibodies and T lymphocytes. And lymphoid follicles because of the aggregation of T lymphocytes having germinal centers. And Hartel cell or oncocytic chain, you can find. Some cells will be very much large and having eosinophilic cytoplasm, they're called Hartel cell, so it's oncocytic chain, due to abundant eosinophilic granular cytoplasm that indicates the destruction of the cell. Okay, they have more mitochondria and because cells are destroyed, they become large and filled with eosinophilic cytoplasm, that's called Hartel cells. Or oncocytic change with abundant eosinophilic granular cytoplasm. These are the features, microscopic features we find in Hashimoto's thyroiditis. So usually they present with hypothyroidism initially because of destruction. It is the most common cause of hypothyroidism. Sometimes hyperthyroidism, because when the follicles are destroyed, already form T3 and T4, they are released very suddenly, leading to very severe sudden hyperthyroidism or hyperoxytocytosis, or toxic the toxic like situation with a toxic very severe hyperthyroidism clinical features. So it's called hyperoxytocytosis. Okay, and there's a high risk of B cell lymphoma here because of the involvement of B cells producing various antibodies, and they are sometimes they are undergoing neoplastic proliferation because of over activity and reactive situation. There will be high risk of B cell lymphoma also in Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Okay, next type of thyroiditis is granulomatous thyroiditis. It is also called decurvains. Decurvains or granulomatous thyroiditis. So it's so that because you find a lot of the number of granulomas and giant cells you find, like in tuberculosis, you find the same picture. That's why it's called granulomatous thyroiditis. The most common cause of painful thyroid enlargement and may follow viral infection. And granulomatous inflammation occurs with multinucleated giant cells. You can see these multinucleated giant cells having this granulomatous inflammation. Okay. Most common cause of painful thyroid enlargement may follow viral infection and granulomatous inflammation with multinucleated giant cells. So this is the decurvains or granulomatous thyroiditis. Coming to Riddle's thyroiditis. Riddle's means the intense fibrous replacement. You know, there are some situations where you find more fibrosis in the neck region, and that fibrosis will extend into the thyroid gland. So the intense fibrous replacement of thyroid gland is called Riddle's thyroiditis, and it shows as if it's some infiltrating malignancy. It appears like that, some clinical features, but actually there is no malignancy here. It's only the invading bands of fibrotic tissue from the neck into the thyroid gland. It's called as intense fibrous replacement of thyroid gland and producing inflammatory reaction. That is called Riddle's thyroiditis. But there is no malignancy here, but it is just mimics or appears like malignancy, but it's actually not a malignancy. Okay, I think here we'll stop with these inflammatory conditions and hyper and hypofunctioning and inflammatory conditions. And next class, I will tell about the thyroid tumors. Okay? There are different types of benign and malignant tumors. I'll tell about some adenomas and some carcinomas. So this is all the slides which we have covered today. Okay, anyway, I will stop here. So next class, I will try to cover. I will see. Let's see how many tumors we'll cover, or one or two more classes we need to finish the endocrine system disorders. Thank you.